In all parts of the world and across all time periods, humans have taken steps to ensure that their deceased loved ones may rest in peace. Markers are placed, burial grounds are hallowed, and superstitious whispers warn of ghastly fates that await those who dare violate the sanctity of the dead. In 1923, those fates were tempted when archaeologists unearthed the tomb of a long-forgotten king in the deserts of Egypt. They had discovered much more than the golden treasures of a royal burial and a 3,000-year-old mummy, for unbeknownst to them, that tomb was cursed. What followed was a series of murders, suicides, miseries, and disasters, not unlike the biblical plagues of the Pharaohs. Join me as we open an ancient chapter of the Datacombs in this installment of Cursed, the Tomb of Tutankhamen. The man responsible for digging up our subject was Howard Carter, a British archaeologist and amateur Egyptologist. He arrived in Egypt in 1891 and gained so much experience excavating and cataloging tombs that by 1899, the Egyptian government offered him a job as an antiquities inspector in Luxor. Despite the fact that no pharaoh's tomb had ever been found intact, Carter became convinced that the valley held at least one undisturbed tomb, that of a long-forgotten 19-year-old who had died over 3,000 years earlier, Tutankhamen. In 1905, a violent altercation with a group of drunken French tourists at a dig site prompted Carter to resign his post with the Egyptian Antiquities Service. The unemployed, resourceless archaeologist set out to find Tutankhamen on his own, but failed to secure independent funding, until he met George Herbert, the 5th Earl of Carnarvon. Lord Carnarvon had lived an uneventful life as a privileged member of the English aristocracy until 1903, when a near-fatal car accident left him a semi-invalid, suffering from intense pain and plagued by ill health that would last for the rest of his life. His doctor suggested that he spend the winter outside of the bitterly cold English weather, and after he had recovered sufficiently enough to travel, Lord and Lady Carnarvon traveled to Egypt. During their stay, Carnarvon began collecting antiques and developed a keen interest in archaeology. In 1907, he agreed to finance the excavation of a series of tombs near Thebes and was introduced to Howard Carter. They proved to be a successful team. Carter soon discovered the burial temples of Hatshepsut and her son Thutmose I in the Valley of the Kings. Inspired by their success, Carnarvon agreed to finance Carter's quest for the Tomb of Tutankhamen. Their search began in 1914, but was soon interrupted by the outbreak of World War I. Work resumed in 1917, and Carter dug for 5 more years with little success. In the fall of 1922, Carnarvon summoned Carter to England to inform him that he was withdrawing his support for the search. Carter talked his noble patron into financing one more season of digging, and returned to Egypt, bringing a yellow canary with him. His foreman is said to have remarked, "A golden bird, it will lead us to the tomb." On November 4th, Carter's workmen uncovered a series of steps buried under debris left over from the building of the tomb of Ramses IV. These stairs led to a door that appeared to be sealed, but upon closer inspection, had been opened by ancient grave robbers. However, the innermost door had not, and the doorway was inscribed with the name Tutankhamen. It was the luckiest day of Carter's life, though as we shall see, perhaps not so fortunate for his patron. Carter reburied the stairway and sent a telegram to notify Lord Carnarvon of the discovery. Carnarvon and his daughter, Lady Evelyn Herbert, immediately departed England, and on November 26, they watched as Carter made a small hole in the door and held up a candle and peered inside. Carnarvon asked, "Can you see anything?" To which Carter replied, "Yes, wonderful things." The tomb was filled with a treasure trove of gold, including jewelry, statues, weapons, a chariot, and a massive stone sarcophagus. Inside, three nested coffins held the undisturbed, mummified remains of King Tutankhamun. It was the first discovery of its kind. When Carter arrived home that night, he found that his canary had been killed by a cobra, an ancient Egyptian symbol of royal power. His servant is said to have remarked, "The Pharaoh's serpent ate the bird because it led us to the hidden tomb. You must not disturb the tomb." Carter dismissed this warning as superstitious nonsense. However, it would prove to be an omen of things to come. The discovery of the tomb soon made international headlines, and Carter became a celebrity overnight. Much to his annoyance, the press hounded him, and the site was soon bombarded by reporters and curious visitors from around the world. To recoup his many years of financial investment and fund further excavation work, Carnarvon sold the exclusive rights to the story to the London Times in exchange for an upfront payment of 5,000 English pounds and 75% of the profits from global newspaper sales. This deal made other newspapers and their reporters absolutely fucking furious. Denied official access to the tomb, they instead began to print any odd gossip or rumor they could lay their hands on, including more ominous stories of birds. The tomb was officially opened on February 17, 1923. Newspapers reported that a falcon was seen flying over the excavation site, and that a cobra had killed Lord Carnarvon's canary. According to these stories, Egyptian workers believed that they were warnings against further intrusion of the sacred burial chamber, sent by the spirit of Tutankhamun himself. These tales were innocent enough, and there was no mention of a deadly ancient curse. Those rumors would only appear after history's most unfortunate shaving accident. Several weeks after the tomb was opened, Carnarvon cut himself while shaving, slicing open an infected mosquito bite in the process. He soon fell ill with a raging fever and severe pain, developed pneumonia, and died an agonizing death of blood poisoning on April 3, 1923, at the age of 56. At the exact moment of his death, a massive power failure plunged the city of Cairo into darkness. Back home in England, Carnarvon's son reported that his father's favorite dog suddenly let out a deafening howl before dropping dead. Newspapers lapped up the story, ignoring the fact that Lord Carnarvon had suffered from bad health and a series of lung infections for many years. Instead, they speculated that his death was supernatural, an act of revenge from beyond the grave. Tutankhamun's curse had claimed its first victim. On April 6th, the Western Daily Press reported that Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the famous author of Sherlock Holmes and a fervent spiritualist, believed Carnarvon's death was caused by an evil elemental. He backed up his claim with the following story. There was once a mummy in the British Museum, which it was believed was guarded by one of those elementals, for everyone who came into contact with it came to grief. This was the mummy of a queen, and even one of my dear friends, a journalist who investigated the misfortunes that befell those who handled the mummy, was himself stricken with typhoid fever and died. The story was soon picked up by newspapers across the globe. On April 9th, the Austin American published an article with the headline, "Pharaoh Discoverer Killed by Old Curse." In Australia, the Argus reported that Carnarvon's death was caused by the malign influence of the dead pharaoh. Both the Times in London and New York World magazine published letters from another best-selling novelist, Marie Corelli, in which she declared, "I cannot but think some risks are run by breaking into the last resting place of a king of Egypt, whose tomb is specially and solemnly guarded, and robbing him of his possessions. According to a rare book I possess, the most dire punishment follows any rash intruder into the sealed tomb." Supposedly, the tomb's door was engraved with a curse. "Death shall come on swift wings to him who disturbs the peace of the king." None of Carter's detailed reports mentioned such a curse, but he kept that fact private and allowed the story to develop in hopes that fear would keep the public away from the tomb. Cursed or not, what cannot be denied is that soon, more people associated with the tomb would die. The curse's next victim was an American millionaire and close friend of Carnarvon, George J. Gould I. After visiting the tomb in May, he immediately fell ill, and just over a month after his friend's death, he too passed away. Another millionaire, Wolf Joel, was murdered after his visit to the tomb. In September, Carnarvon's half-brother also died of blood poisoning, and an Egyptian prince who had visited the tomb was shot to death by his wife. In 1924, a radiologist named Sir Archibald Douglas Reed x-rayed the boy king's mummy. 3 days later, he was dead. Later that year, an archaeologist who worked on the tomb named Hugh Evelyn White suffered a nervous breakdown and hung himself. his suicide note, allegedly written in blood, reads, "I have succumbed to a curse which forces me to despair." Not all victims of the curse died, however. According to legend, Carter gave a most unusual gift to his friend, Sir Bruce Ingham, in the form of a paperweight made of a mummified human hand, which wore a bracelet inscribed, "Cursed be he who moves my body." Shortly after receiving the morbid present, Ingham's house burned to the ground. When he tried to rebuild, a flood destroyed the half-built home. James Henry Breasted, another famous Egyptologist of the day, also survived the curse. He was present when the tomb was opened, and when he returned home, he found that his pet canary was missing from its cage. In its place was, you guessed it, a cobra. In 1926, another Egyptologist and close friend of Carnarvon named Aaron Ember fell victim to the curse. His house mysteriously caught fire, and despite having ample time to escape, he died while attempting to rescue the manuscript of a book he was working on, The Book of the Dead. The curse's body count continued to rise. A French Egyptologist named Georges Benedict died of a stroke shortly after visiting the tomb. Arthur Mace, a member of the doomed excavation team, died of arsenic poisoning in 1928. In 1929, Carter's secretary, Richard Bethel, was found smothered to death in his hotel room. According to the Nottingham Evening Post, the suggestion that the Honorable Richard Bethel has come under the curse was raised last year when there was a series of mysterious fires at his home, where some of the priceless finds from Tutankhamun's tomb were stored. Bethel's father, archaeologist Lord Westbury, was so grief-stricken that he committed suicide in 1930 by jumping out of a seventh-story window. He left behind a note that read, "I really cannot stand any more horrors and hardly see what good I am going to do here, so I am making my exit." During his funeral, his hearse was making its way to the cemetery when it struck down two young children, killing an 8-year-old boy. The press blamed each and every one of these tragedies on the mummy's curse. Newspapers claimed that Lord Westbury had been plagued by thoughts of death and was often heard muttering about the curse of the Pharaohs. By 1935, 21 deaths had been attributed to the curse, including 6 unnamed French journalists and 3 pet birds. Was it possible that this series of freak fires, sudden deaths, and tragic suicides really was payback for the defiling of an ancient king's tomb? Carter didn't think so. He angrily dismissed the idea as tommyrot, and in an interview with the New York Times, he remarked, "It is rather too much to ask me to believe that some spook is keeping watch and ward over the dead pharaoh, ready to wreak vengeance on anyone who goes too near." His denial of the curse sparked rumors that he was collaborating with unspecified authorities to hide evidence the curse was indeed killing off those who defiled the tomb. His miserable, lonely death from Hodgkin's disease on March 2, 1939, was seen as proof of this conspiracy. Evidence suggests that the curse was nothing more than an invention of the press. Historians dispute whether or not a tablet bearing a curse was found in Tutankhamun's tomb, and newspapers often printed mistranslations of texts to make them seem more menacing. An innocent inscription on a shrine to Anubis that read, "I am the one who prevents the sand from blocking the secret chamber," appeared in the papers as, "I will kill all of those who cross the threshold into the sacred precincts of the royal king who lives forever." In the decade following its discovery, only 6 people connected to Tutankhamun's tomb are confirmed to have died, all of whom suffered from poor health long before they entered the ancient burial chamber. On average, those who were involved in the opening of the tomb and subsequent work survived the curse for 23 years. Carnarvon's daughter, Lady Evelyn Herbert, lived for a full 56 years after witnessing the tomb's opening. After all, if there had been a curse, wouldn't Carter have been the main target? He lived for 17 years after the tomb was opened, and his obituary in the New York Times declared that Mr. Carter himself was the best refutation of the curse. If Tutankhamun had any connection to these series of deaths, it wasn't supernatural. Modern scientific research suggests that the tomb may have contained toxic black mold, which lay dormant for millennia before its spores were inhaled by unsuspecting archaeologists. Indeed, several eyewitness reports mentioned the black fungus was present in the tomb. Those who were predisposed to infections, like Carnarvon, would have been particularly affected by exposure to these toxic fungi. According to a 1998 study by French researcher Dr. Sylvain Gandon, the death of Lord Carnarvon could potentially be explained by infection with a highly virulent and very long-lived pathogen. This may not have been an accident, however. Gandon notes that if the Egyptians were smart and really wanted to make a curse, they could have taken a pathogen well known to them and put it in the tomb. In another study, German microbiologist Gotthard Kramer analyzed 40 Egyptian mummies and found several strains of mold spores on each of them, some of which were potentially deadly. However, according to evolutionary biologist Dr. Charlotte Reliff Moore of Oxford University, the theory of infection caused by ancient mold spores is mildly plausible as an explanation for Lord Carnarvon's death, writing, "As far as I know, I can think of no parasite or spore-forming pathogen that infects humans and fits Lord Carnarvon's description of symptoms." Although from an evolutionary ecology perspective, it is not impossible to imagine that it could exist. Science, statistics, and historical research provide a veritable mountain of evidence against the story of the curse of Tutankhamun's tomb. Surely, the logical conclusion is that the tragedies surrounding Carter's discovery are mere coincidences, unfortunate events with rational explanations. Regardless of your opinion, the legend is a fascinating one, though I have yet to mention one last piece of the puzzle, a postscript to our case that may be seen as proof of supernatural involvement. When the mummy of Tutankhamun was unwrapped, it is said to have had a scarab-like wound on its left cheek, in the same exact spot as Carnarvon's lethal mosquito bite. Professor Douglas Derry, the man who conducted the autopsy, mysteriously died shortly thereafter.